It seems like there's a lot of pictures of asteroids these days that don't make a lot of sense. I know I'm an unwashed woo master without the grueling mathematics necessary to be allowed into the mainstream puzzle factory, but maybe someone can help me out and explain how this asteroid walked away from an impact that left this crater on it without getting blown into space dust. If the vaunted experts are correct and cratering comes from collisions, this was the equivalent of a Mack truck plowing into a golf cart at 150 miles per hour, and the golf cart continuing on to the next hole. Even better, a lot of these guys have been hit multiple times by similar impacts, not to mention countless smaller ones. Now out here in Realville, a collision like that would have turned this rock into a pile of dancing atoms, but not in the Big Bang multiverse where literally anything can happen with enough funding and imagination. The experts say the story of asteroids all began way back in the murky depths of our primordial past, where they accreted out of neutral gas, billions of years ago. Accreting is when little rocks and dust in the early solar system smashed into each other at ludicrous speed. Then, for reasons I do not understand, supposedly all stuck together and got bigger until they became asteroids, rather than blowing into smaller bits of dust as one might expect. Unlike planets who kept on accreting until they were planets, asteroids did not. The experts suspect it could have something to do with the gravitational influence of the emerging gas giant Jupiter, but it's just a guess. Now, because of the assumed interrupted history of asteroids, a lot of experts believe they must therefore keep a pristine record of what things were like in the early solar system, much like comets, who the experts view as being made out of the primordial ice that comes from the legendary but cleverly hidden Oort cloud, way out deep in the solar system, where we conveniently have no way to verify its actual existence. I'm sure it's there. These speculative notions have been around now for decades, and as we've shown in the past, science writers often forget to distinguish between speculation and fact. And by often, I mean pretty much all the time. But here's the truth. The standard model of comet formation is a wild guess, and now that we keep landing on them and can't seem to find all that water and ice they dreamed up, we know it wasn't a particularly accurate guess. Well, everyone makes mistakes, though generally we're supposed to update when experimental data blows our theories out of the water. One undeniable fact is that recent photographs of these bodies pose severe challenges to popular ideas about them. Asteroids don't have a lot of gravitational oomph compared to planets and moons, and most of the stuff traveling in their neighborhood is going in the same direction. Without the gravity to bring in stuff hot, and with very few rocks going against traffic, it's pretty hard to imagine the standard impact theory being possible, especially when it requires high-speed collisions in the thousands of miles per hour to happen. After these rocks formed, one might ask, where did they get all those craters? They're covered in them. Countless small circular craters, and almost always a few that look like they should have been planet killers. But in fact, they've all got them. It's a common feature of asteroids. And that's a little confusing to me. Even more confusing is the fact that all these craters are at a perfect 90-degree angle. Almost as if an electric arc had run across the surface. But Mr. Narrator! That would be insane. What are you, some kind of crackpot? Clearly, the rational answer is that trillions of asteroid impacts on them all happen to strike at an exact 90-degree angle, way out in space where there are no atmospheres to cause airbursts. Trillions of them, all at 90-degree angles, in case that was lost on anyone. If the impact theory of crater formation were true, observation suggests that each body was struck by at least one rock, some by more than one, of sufficient size and velocity to shatter the body. But none were shattered. The asteroids have not only remained intact, but they show no evidence of cracking or splintering under the stress. It's a chestnut, ladies and gentlemen, and will remain one to the experts until one of them manages to cook up some new magic particle that explains it all. I expect they've already got math wizards working on it around the clock. Get your Nobel Prizes ready. Better pictures coming in from space started to cause such problems with the accretion theory that astrophysicists began to speculate that perhaps asteroids were formed by an aggregation of lesser rocks. A similar turn occurred when the standard comet model began to fail. When comets such as Linear broke up, the cometologists, who must get their degrees from the same place the asteroid guys do, could have only imagined this happening if they were loose aggregates of separate pieces, or perhaps something tenuous, like an icy fluff ball. Sadly, none of our actual visits to asteroids or comets actually support these notions. Quite the opposite, actually. The best pictures suggest rock-solid objects, as can be seen in these images. As far as comets go, by NASA's own admission, the deep impact on Temple 1 effectively ended speculation about comets as loose aggregations. So what does this confusing hodgepodge of comet and asteroid formation theory have in common? It's all wrong. Turns out, it's the electric model of space that can explain what we actually see. What need has the electric universe for rocks smashing into one another like drunken bumper cars when we believe the history of the universe is brimming with intense energetic events and violent electrical interactions between planets and moons? Just the sorts of things you'd expect to smash everything into rubble and throw it into space. The scars we see on planets, moons, and asteroids don't come from collisions. They come from electric arcs. These arcs have the ability to cut surface depressions, to scoop out material, and to accelerate it into space, leaving behind cleanly cut geological relief in perfectly circular craters. How do we know? Because we use electric arcs to do exactly this every day in common electrical discharge machining, EDM. Unlike the mathematical nonsense the experts pretend is real, we know how EDM machines work. And we know the electrical machining effects they produce is scalable, probably infinitely scalable. In the photograph here of the asteroid Eta, the right side exhibits sharply cut gouges that altered the fundamental shape of the body. The same asteroid showed a depression on its westward termination almost as wide as its diameter. Could impacts have achieved these things while leaving no other evidence of disturbance? Well, this is where I put my hand up. No, teacher, they could not have done that. But what about the asteroid Eros? This one. Here we are up close and personal with the near spacecraft. To get these craters, each with the diameter equal to the width of this thing, they'd have to have broadsided it at least a few times. And what about the asteroid Matilda? More inconceivable impacts. At its closest approach, near flew within 1,200 kilometers of Matilda. As stated in the report by the Planetary Society, quote, "The images show a surface covered with craters, some surprisingly large in size. At least five of the craters imaged by NIR are over 20 kilometers in size. To form craters that large, Matilda had to be hit by objects nearly 2 kilometers in size. It is amazing that such collisions didn't completely break apart the asteroid." End quote. Amazing indeed, my friend, but apparently no amount of amazing and clearly impossible stuff is reason enough to question the super-condensed insanity of the Big Bang model. Still not convinced that the standard model is trying to hoodwink you? We've included, on the right below, 5 pictures for your viewing pleasure. The asteroid Gaspra, taken on Galileo's approach. If the large craters were caused by impact, then my 2-year-old can take a left hook from Mike Tyson. Notice how these impacts succeeded in creating depressions almost as wide as the diameter of the body itself, all without screwing up any of the terrain around it. If these things were made by collision, then hurry up and go mine that baby. Wakanda needs vibranium, and that ain't no ordinary rock, Professor. To the surprise of absolutely no one who watches this channel, asteroids and comets are yet another inexplicable mystery to the standard model, whose guesses were about as useful as an X-Men with the ability to communicate with Korn. So if you're interested in learning how space actually works, according to a model that won't get you laughed at in a few decades, then I hope you'll continue to tune into the Thunderbolts Project as we uncover more of the mysteries of this amazing electric universe.